domains that we have, and in all these domains we carry out consultancy as well as training programs. These are self-run training program as well as in-company training programs. So broad areas of NPC services are in the area of organizational redesign, restructuring, and manpower planning, lean manufacturing, productivity and competitiveness measurement studies, project management, performance management. Then we have started off new services as recruitment services, wherein we carry out online and offline examination and recruitment services, and then consultancy and training on people quality management. Also, we are taking up resource efficiency and waste management related to the environmental management and energy conservation and efficiency and management related to the sustainability. And then we carry out some audits also, like in the area of environment, energy, and water. Then we carry out certification for 5S in the RTI, the transparency, food safety, and quality audit. We also, from the agriculture side, we also take up state and district agriculture plans. We develop these schemes also. And in the UP government, we are doing on a very big scale. Then we carry out impact assessment, monitoring, and evaluation of various central and state government schemes. And we have been one of the main pioneers in this area. And then we carry out, as I told, that we carry out training programs also related to the management development, the top level, medium level, and the operating level. So these are some of the broad areas that we carry out. We have these government as well as public clients that we have. Basically, they are from PSUs and ministries, various ministries, as you can see. And we also cater to the private and international organizations. So if you look at our revenue that we make, 45% comes from this private and international agencies, and 55% comes from government agencies. So we are we do provide services in a very big way to the private organizations also. Now, talking about this particular session, this is being given to you. We have come to you through this Center of Excellence, which has been set up at NPC Delhi in collaboration with the APO, Asian Productivity Organization. And this has been set up with a mandate to be a knowledge center to disseminate knowledge of Industry 4.0 through workshop, lectures, and training, and to facilitate display of these latest technologies demonstration projects. So we are initially we have started taking up. This was set up. This central excellence was set up at in 2017, and we have been taking various activities as on date. And at a later stage, we have also a mandate to coordinate with APO in helping other countries to set up similar type of COE in their in those countries, and to give the technological know-how to them, how they should carry out, what kind of framework, what kind of governance structure they need to have, and what kind of activities they need to have. So these are the some of the activities that we need to carry out. And as you may be knowing, that APO is represented by 20 member countries. So these are basically from South Asia and Southeast Asia. We need to collaborate. We collaborate with each other in technology transfer, in the managerial transfers, and all these know-how. As I told you, that we have planned for various activities. So during 1920, then 20 and 21, these are the various activities that we have planned, and which generally comprises of when you talk about the creating an ecosystem of Industry 4.0, Generally, it has to start with what is the status or what is the need assessment of your country or of your sector, of your subsector, those things. So along with that, you also need to create some lighthouse effect. So you have to take up like demo projects, which we are taking it up. And we are also having a technology transfer with Korea and other like Taiwan and other neighbor countries. So these are the various program or various activities that we have planned to be carried out in these 3 years, 1920 and 21, wherein we will be creating an ecosystem throughout India and across India also in these are some of the APO member countries. So let me come to the what is the manufacturing status or in India. I'd like to refer to two main reports published by WEF, World Economic Forum, and I would request you all to go through these two reports. These are very important reports. All those who are interested to know about manufacturing, to know about what kind of digital technologies or what kind of emergence in the digital technologies or digital area is coming up. So these two reports will help you greatly to know like what is the status of India vis-a-vis other countries throughout the world. So this report, if you see into this report, if you go to this report, you will see that these reports actually talk about two drivers that affect the future of production. These are two are structure of production in which there are two sub measures which is actually complexity and scale. Complexity talks about the kind of unique products, mix of unique products that a particular country manufactures. And the scale actually describes about what kind of volume the country manufactures, or what kind of scale or what kind of volume the country deals with. And another driver which drivers of production is that relates to the technology and innovation. There are six things that that are contained that are, that comprises this particular drivers of production. This relates to technology innovation, like what kind of technological environment or innovative environment that a particular country is having, what kind of human capital or what kind of skill upgradation that is needed, or what kind of status of skill, human skill is there in the country. Then what kind of investment and global trade mechanism is there. Then institutional framework deals with the kind of governance structure and the kind of institutional or the educational system support and the kind of rules and regulations which are available in that particular country. Then sustainable resources deals about the what kind of, if the manufacturing is done, what kind of sustainability environment, sustainability is being taken care of. And demand environment deals with the kind of demand framework or the demand, the support from the, as far as the demand is concerned for the products those are being manufactured in a particular country. So these all eight sub-measures actually describe like what is the future readiness of any country. And if you see the analysis of that, and they have placed all the countries, each of the countries in either of these quadrants. So if you see here, the four types of archetypes are leading, legacy, nascent, and high potential. So if leading, if you talk about leading, that obviously talks about that the countries which are having strong current base and they are positioned well for the future. So these are generally the European countries like Germany, Japan, US, European countries. So these are all very well placed. They have a strong structure of production as well as driver of production. When you talk about India, it is being placed under legacy. So that means we are having a very strong structure of production. That means we are having complexity. We manufacture very complex products, and we are having very deal with scale of production also, because we are having a good maybe the market size is good in India. So we have a good structure of production, but we lack on the drivers of production. Then we have some high potential countries who are good in driver of production, but they lack on structure of production. They have very specified production base in their country. And there are some nascent who are some sort of like countries who are weak in both the areas. They have much to do. But the thing which need to be understood in this is that every country is having in their own strategy. Like if you talk about India, we were having good what do you call advantage earlier, since we were having labor force at a lower cheaper labor force. But now, since we this disruptive technologies, as we are talking about, since these disruptive technologies seems to take that benefit from us, and maybe at a later stage it will be carried on to the nascent country. So when you are strategizing, when a particular country is strategizing its own production or manufacturing readiness in future, so these nascent countries are understood to gain benefit out of this, because they will be now more preferred destination for due to their lower labor for the cost. So this is how they have represented India. India is coming under legacy. And if you see the India is to some extent, it is performing, the performance of India is very good, and it is poised to enter into the top quadrant, into leading and become a leading archetype. So by analysis of all these things, what we have understood is that there are challenges as far as driver of production is concerned, and we need to strengthen our institutional framework, which calls for establishing fundamental building block of good governance. And then we are strengthen. We have to strengthen our human capital, and we have to also strengthen our technology and innovation atmosphere environment. So these all call for needing for reskilling, upskilling, and skilling of workforce. Then upgrade technology platform and see proven innovation. So these are some of the areas or initiatives that need to be taken up if India is has to maybe become more competitive as far as the acceptance of these disruptive technologies is concerned. Then another report that talks about, which I would like to refer to, is this Global Competence Index. If you see this Global Competence Index, India has been ranking, has ranked in 2018, it has ranked as 58 out of 141 economies. And if you see, if I'll show you the, this is the 2018 performance of India. And if you see 2019 performance, it is, my screen is not changing much, if you see this. Okay. So the performance of India as far as the what we called on these fronts, like innovation and ICT technologies, if you see, these are somewhat stagnant. And on the other aspect, if you understand, try to understand it, the other countries have progressed more in compared to India. So that's why we are keeping that particular score, as well as rank, similar to 2018. So if you see, there is not a remarkable change that we are having. And in some of the areas, if you see, like some of the areas which you, if you see, like microeconomic stability, if you see, though we are scoring very high, still we are at 43rd. So that means other countries are very strong in this. If you see ICT adoption, we are at 32. That means, and we are at 128. That means there are other countries who have, who are performing better and who are more sturdy and more developed related to this. So these are the two study that I wanted to refer to, which will actually, which is being used by the government also and by other organizations also in framing up the policy and in framing up the strategy for India and for other sectors in India.
Sorry to disturb you, Mr. Umashankar. Please talk how NPC is going to help the industry, the method, process.
I'll come to that, sir. So if you talk about the manufacturing, we have got robust demand. We are increasing. We have increasing investments and policy support. We have Make in India. We have Digital India, Stand Up India. These are various initiatives which the government is taking, and we have competitive advantage also, which due to having young working population. So these are some of the positive side with which we are carrying on, and we are planning. We have objective or aim vision to be that from manufacturing we want to increase from 18% to 25% of the GDP. So these all things actually call for improving the efficiency of manufacturing in India. So now let me give little bit time so that we understand what are the various manufacturing process and how then we will be able to understand in MSME, when I'll be talking about MSME sector as such, how it can be implemented, how NPC will be helping it, that then it will be more meaningful. So these are I'll run through this. These are the various type of manufacturing process, one in repetitive, which does not require more of setup, and it runs for 24/7 all year long and give the same production. Then there are discrete, which there is a small, a little bit of changeovers, and then there are some setups and different new separate products are coming. And then the job shop, which are fixed layout production process. And then the fourth is process batch, in which the production is done in a batch wise with the smaller setups. And then we have a process continuous or analogous, which generally deals with the process industry, the chemical industry, as we know. And then third type of manufacturing, which is coming, is 3D printing, which does not require any changeover or setup like that. So that is another sixth type of manufacturing process, which is coming out due to this technology. So if you, to make you understand what are the various kinds of manufacturing process, these are the repetitive, as you can see, that the same product is going on year long, and discrete, there is changeover, AP like that, and job shop, which are fixed layout. Then process batch, A is produced, then B is produced, C is produced. So this is the kind of the manufacturing process which we generally have everywhere. Now, when you talk about competitiveness, when you talk about shop floor productivity, when you talk about increasing your efficiency, when you talk about increasing your overall equipment effectiveness, then lately what we have seen is that lean manufacturing has been very helpful in that, which is actually removing all the waste from your manufacturing process. So if you see that any manufacturing process, be it MSME, be it a large industry, these waste will be part of that particular manufacturing process or a production process. So these are addressed to five key principles in which lean manufacturing promotes that we need to follow these five key principles. Like value, you need to specify the value desired by the customer. You should know what kind of value you need to deliver to the customer, because customer is the he will be paying you for whatever you deliver. Then you need to have the value stream. You have to identify the value stream for each product and challenge all the wasted steps. Then you have to create a flow in your manufacturing process so as to create a pull in your in the process, so that less and less wastage is there. And then you need to perfect that particular manufacturing process so that your manufacturing is very economical and cost effective. So basically, lean manufacturing talks about improving your cycle time, your lead time, wherein we talk about takt time and lead time, all those things. So I need not go in detail with all those things. But the thing is that lean manufacturing actually deals with the removal of waste so that your manufacturing processes becomes more efficient, your lead time is shortened, and you become more profitable. So these are the kind of waste that is there in each of the in any manufacturing unit, which we on Japanese terms we call it muda, mura, and muri. Muda is waste, which should not be there in the manufacturing process, and mura is unevenness, and muri is overburden. So these three waste actually adds to your inefficiency. And these are the seven waste which lean manufacturing addresses, which we call team mode: over transportation, over inventory, over motion, over waiting, and over output, over operation, over defects. Then how the MSME is poised to take up these disruptive technologies. Now, since I have told you about lean manufacturing, which we have been taking, which we have been talking since long, how, and it has greatly affected the efficiency and the profitability of MSME. So let us understand, like, how is MSME sector, since we are, this particular session, we are keeping on the focus on MSME. We would like to understand, like, how MSME is poised, how it is being placed in the economy. So if I'll just go through a particular this thing, that what is the kind of MSME status as on date. If you see that there are around 63 million MSME in India, out of which micro are 630, 63 million are micro, 3 million are, 3 lakhs are, what do you call, small, and only 5,000 are medium. And the kind of manufacturing, if you see the in MSME, these are the three areas or the three services that we have, that manufacturing, they are dealing either with manufacturing, trade, or other services. So manufacturing, which we are talking about, actually is having a 36 catering to 36 or provided 36 million jobs or employment we are having in the MSME sectors related to manufacturing. So, and in the along due course, you have you see that there has been a 6% growth in manufacturing in from 2006 to 2015. It is the last census that we have. So right now we are having around 19 million manufacturing units throughout the country. So which generally majorly comprises of micro, and this is the biggest challenge that we need to have as far as implementation of disruptive technology is concerned. Now let me talk about two, three aspects of MSME units which we need to cater to when we are designing or when we are trying to provide support to the manufacturing industry. So one is like the kind of delayed payment that they're suffering from, due to which the debtor days, their debtor days is generally more than 100 or 200 days, and due to the, which forces them to have a more and more working capital. So they have their, that's why they are facing more of a fund problem, because their fund gets stuck up in their in the whole cycle. Now, when we talk, this is the second aspect. And when we talk about the readiness of MSME, digitization. So a study carried out by Google and KPMG, if you see that there are, these are the kind of MSMEs that we have currently in India. There are some MSMEs which we can call offline. They don't have any internet connectivity. Maybe one of the, they'll have their personal computer. There are some like who are enabled, who have their own website, use social media for instance, and maintain a corporate email ID to engage in their customer base. So generally you will for general information gathering and communication, but do not use the internet for business purpose. And there are very few who are engaged. This is what we are talking about. This is what where we want to take to this platform, where we can say that these manufacturing unit or these MSMEs are engaged, wherein they use digital technologies to enable their business. That is being generated throughout their manufacturing. This is the what you call the aim that NPC has, to convert or to migrate maximum extent from offline enabled connected to engaged. Because if you see, the only 2% are right now they are engaged. So they need to be digitally engaged so that their growth trajectory can be improved. These are the three aspects that we need to have, the capacity to compete, capacity to change, and capacity to connect if they want to become competitive. So capacity to compete means they should have their operational efficiency, and they should have that particular change management in the place, and then they need to have a capacity to gather and exploit business related relevant information and knowledge. These are things that I'll be discussing now. I'll just, these are the various, for improving competitiveness, these are the various aspects that we need to look into when we provide, or when we provide support to the MSME, that what kind of cluster-based approach, like what kind of cluster-based manufacturing system that they are having, what kind of collaboration they are having among MSME, and what kind of e-marketplace they are having, and then sustained on-ground support, what kind of hand-holding mechanism that they are having, and what kind of global competence to marketing, and how data is being shared with them. So NPC is actually working in all, supporting the MSMEs in all these areas. So that they are, I'll talk like what kind of initiative that we are taking, how we are hand-holding the MSMEs. One of the hand-holding initiative or this project that we have handled is Lean Manufacturing Competitiveness Scheme, which has been sponsored by Ministry of MSME. And through our intervention, we have done intervention in around 1,900 MSMEs, and which has resulted into a saving of 143 crores. So these are MSMEs from engineering and allied sectors, auto sector and allied sector, and other sectors, and other like gems and jewelry and food processing. So these are the various ministries, the various clusters in which we have carried out hand-holding. But it was related to lean manufacturing, wherein we improved their efficiency, their profitability through these improving their transport inventory, this waste, removing their waste, and improving their value stream. So now let me talk about how this Industry 4.0 concepts and technologies will be helping these MSMEs in improving their operational efficiency, improving their manufacturing process. So let me talk about, you must have heard about these four industrial revolution. We are into fourth industrial revolution, as we have been talking about since long, which actually deals with creating a digital environment or digital factory in which there is a connectedness between the machine to machine, between, and we create a environment of Internet of Things and Internet of Services. So if you see, the first industrial revolution was actually talking about the craft and production, wherein we used some mechanical process and through which we did our manufacturing process. And then in second industrial revolutions, we used the mass production with the help of electrical and electronic help, with electrical and electronic help. And then we in the third industrial revolution, which actually talked about the usage of IT and information technology, ICT, which has been all about, and communication through automating the, our whole process. But the thing between the third industrial revolution and fourth industrial revolution, the difference between this thing is the third industrial revolution, we automated things, but we did not connect. Very few organizations, as on date, they have connected their machines or their physical properties or physical facilities. In industrial revolutions, we are talking about integrating this whole thing. Now, let me talk about a little bit about this data. So, in this, if you see this in this fourth industrial revolution, we are talking about connectedness. We are talking about when we are talking about connectedness, what we are actually dealing. When we are talking about connectedness, that means we are actually transferring. We are actually generating or collecting data from one from each of the machines through some mechanism, through having some embedded system in the machines or embedded system in our whole manufacturing process. So the main thing is that we are actually having a communication system, interconnected communication system, in which we generate data. And those data is as on date are very big. If you see in a particular in the manufacturing industry, during the whole day, voluminous data is being generated. And these voluminous data, in some organizations, these are either stored or and in some of the organizations, these are not actually collected or these are not stored. So those organizations who are storing it, they don't have any idea how to use it. So Industry 4.0 actually talks about using those data so that you become more informed. So you become more informed. You become predictive in nature. You become you become intelligent. Now, when we talk about these data, so these data, if you can see that these data are in various, like these are there are volume of data which have been generated. These are variety of data which have been generated, and the velocity of data is tremendous. If you can see from here. We have a variety of data which are coming from people to people or people to machine or machine to machine. These are various type of data which are being generated, which we capture. And we need to understand these things. We need to analyze these things. Okay, then there are velocity of data. If you see, there are 2.9 million emails sent every second. 20 hours of YouTube video are being uploaded. 50 million tweets are being done per day. Now, these all data are to be collected. First of all, these are very voluminous data, and these need to be collected in order to gain some information. These are data. So these data cannot be of any use to us. So until and unless we analyze these data, they cannot be used fruitfully. So these data need to be understood. These data need to be analyzed. Okay. So. But the problem is that apart from these variables, we also have another aspect of these data, that these data are generally generated in the form of unstructured format, right? So if you see from this bar graph, most of the data which is being generated is in the unstructured format. So there has to be some analysis to be done so that to understand this unstructured data or to convert this unstructured data into structured data so that you can infer something out of it and then you can use it into your business strategy. So we add a fourth dimension to this, that is, what is the veracity of data? So data uncertainty, how we change, how do we manage this, the reliability of the data? And once we are able to use this data and analyze this data, then comes how do we generate value out of it. So until and unless, if you see from the on the left hand side, these are volume, velocity, these are data are being crammed up, then there are some variety of where we do some analytics, we change them into some form, and then we actually understand, and then we carry out, we come out with solution. So when we come out with this solution, then only we can say that out of those data we have generated some value. we have got some information which will help me in carrying out some help related to my business activity. So data in crude form is of no use. Data has to be converted into some form, which understandable form, which will help us in our business activity. Now, for these things, say that we use so many technologies and which actually comprise with what we call Industry 4.0. So Industry 4.0 is actually the movement, which is actually the approach in which we use these various technologies. So if you see the definition of Industry 4.0, it says that the so-called fourth industrial revolution is characterized by individualization, even in mass production. That means even a particular industry or a particular plant is manufacturing in mass, how it can be individualized? That means each and every product can be individualized. So that is the limit or the control that we need to have, that we can have through Industry 4.0, through the usage of these Industry 4.0 technologies. And then we can also have hybridization of products. That means instead, we apart from production or providing products to the customer, how we can embed that particular product along with the service. So how do we top up service on that on top of that? And that is why you must have heard about circular economy. So this is these things are based on the circular economy is based on this concept only, wherein you hybridize your product, wherein you provide the product and you provide the service also, and the integration of customer and business partner in business and value added process. So essential components in this Industry 4.0, the component that we use, they are actually embedded system, and which will characterize our machines to become more autonomous, to become more smart, and in long term intelligent, right? So our whole facility has to become smart as well as to become more intelligent, so that they become autonomous. So they can take their own, they can analyze, they can take their own decision. So that moves in and through environments without human control and make decisions on their own, and developments such as 3D printers, which I just now talked about, that the third kind of manufacturing process is coming as 3D printers.
Only 15 minutes are left, Umaji.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. The networking of technologies and chip-based objects results in highly complex structures and cyber-physical systems. So this actually create the cyber-physical systems, which we call Internet of Things. So basically, in Industry 4.0, what we are talking about is, if you see on the left-hand side, there is a computerization and there is a connectivity. Apart from that, the visibility, transparency, predictability, and adaptability, this is what is Industry 4.0, wherein we know, like, we have connected our machines, but we want to see, we want to create a visible effect. So what is happening actually, that we can see in the form of dashboard. And then why does it happen? So there is a data analytics, there is an analysis of that, why it is happening. So there is a data analytics in that. And what will happen? Then we predict it, that why it is happening, how it will happen. There is a logic or the simulation involved in that. And then how can autonomous reaction take place, self-optimizing. They can take their own decision. The machine takes their own decision. So they become self-optimizing. So this is what is actually Industry 4.0. We have to convert, or we have to migrate our manufacturing process to make them more smart and make them more intelligent, so that they become more autonomous. This is what is actually in crux what is Industry 4.0. Now, we use these various technologies. These are the 9 technologies which actually drive Industry 4.0 in the form. I will not go in detail, but these are some of the technologies: advanced manufacturing solution, additive manufacturing, augmented reality, simulation, horizontal vertical integration, industrial internet, cloud, cybersecurity, big data analytics. These are the various technologies which we help when we carry out an intervention in any of the manufacturing unit or any of the unit, any of the plant. These are the various technologies. These are technologies are used to provide the creating a smart factory. Now, if you talk about the kind of analysis to be done in any industry which is migrating into Industry 4.0, these are the five aspects that need to be looked into, like Internet of Things, horizontal and vertical integration, the cyber physical system, Internet of Services, and smart factory. So you have to connect everything through Internet of Things. You have to integrate horizontal and vertical, horizontally and vertically, your manufacturing process to create a cyber physical system, and also to provide your services over the internet so that it becomes a smart factory. So these are the various key elements. Now let me explain like what is actually horizontal and vertical integration, and I'll also discuss about the automation stack which Industry 4.0 is talking about. See, if this is a supply chain which a supplier, there is a supplier, there is a manufacturer, and there is a customer. So there is a horizontal integration across the supply chain, and within the supplier they have their own manufacturing process, they have their own production process. Similarly, manufacturers, they have their own assembly process, their own manufacturing process, their own production process. Similarly, customer, they have their own process. Customer can be your downstream manufacturer. It cannot be like end user. It can also be your manufacturer also. So they also have their own manufacturing process. So this is what is actually talking about in Industry 4.0, what kind of horizontal and vertical integration. So this actually Industry 4.0 goes out of your premises, goes out of your facility to integrate the whole supply chain. It is integrating your inside premise also, as well as integrating with the external supply chain, and this is what we call extended supply chain. Now, if you see the kind of stack in any of the manufacturing unit, they understand that these are the various stacks that they have. There is a machine layer, there is a SCADA supervisory control, and there is a manufacturing execution system, and then the ERP, enterprise resource planning, and top of that you have cloud. So if you see on the right hand side, if you see the five type of scenario which horizontal and vertical system talks about, which we need to understand the kind of intervention on the when we are trying to migrate from a machine from automated environment to a connected environment. So these are the various types of vertical and horizontal integration which are possible in any manufacturing unit. So you can have a soft floor to top floor, but the vertical integration, and then machine to machine e-commerce integration, wherein you integrate with the cloud, and then manufacturing collaboration and machine cloud, wherein you actually carry out the data analytics and you carry out the predictive maintenance and predictive quality of your manufacturing process. Now, Industry 4.0 also talks about, if you see here, actually what we are doing is that there is an ERP, and these are the MES, SCADA, and machine layer. These are actually physical attributes. Machine manufacturing execution system actually talks about the how do you plan for your manufacturing process. SCADA, how do you control your manufacturing process. And then machine layer, actually at the machine, what kind of control that you are having at the operator level. So these are the various OT system, operational technology system, that is there in any manufacturing process. And along with that, with them, you need to integrate with your ERP and with your various technologies that you need to have for converting into Industry 4.0. So you need to have this merging and the convergence of IT and OT so that you become seamless. You become seamless become seamless through industrial Internet of Things. It is not nothing new. It is actually Internet of Things, which in an industrial environment we call industrial Internet of Things. So industrial Internet of Things, which we generally talk about, which is actually the main essence of Industry 4.0, requires the convergence of IT and OT. Now let me talk about this applicability and implementation aspects in MSME, how we in NPC, we are handholding the MSMEs, and what kind of new initiatives that we are coming up with. So we are talking about digital transformation. So there is a concept like digitization, then digitalization and digital transformation. Digitization is when we are converting from analog to digital mode, and then digitalization is when you are making your business into digital format. We are using these digital technologies or technologies to become digital. And digital transformation comprises various digital usage of various digital technologies. When you say that you are transforming digitally, when you are having digital transformation. So before that, I'd like to show you that video that we have, the kind of intervention that we have done. On the NPC website, if anybody is interested, they can please visit NPC website and see that particular video. This actually talks about the intervention of Industry 4.0, which we have carried out in an automobile component manufacturer. So this is a very interesting video, which I'll request you to go through on our website. You visit our website and see that. So what kind of initiative that we need to have? And this actually, when we are carrying out any intervention with this, are having these four phases that any Industry 4.0 initiative has. That is, one is need assessment analysis, then target identification and project realization and capacity building and change management. Need assessment, we actually carry out what is the readiness of a particular company or a particular manufacturing process. So, if you see if you the experts on Industry 4.0, they say that Industry 4.0 is a newer concept, there are chances that Industry 4.0, the intervention taken under Industry 4.0 are not so lucrative at the first instance. So they say that there should be a number of pockets of intervention to be done in your factory shop floor, so that there are, because you are bound to get mixed type of result from each of the intervention. So there will be some pockets where we will not get an encouraging result. There will be some where we will be getting a very encouraging result. So this will actually help you to get motivated and to visualize and appreciate the usage of in I4.0 technologies. Then once you carry out this need assessment, then we come out with what are the various areas or the low hanging fruits and high hanging fruits, the long range perspective that we need to take. And then out of that, we then carry out a project realization process in which we zero down on one, two or three projects, and then we carry out a particular intervention. And the last part is the reskilling part, upskilling part, which we through which we strengthen the manufacturing process and the enterprise. So these are the various phases that we in which we carry out a particular consultancy project or various handholding intervention that we have. If you can see in the starting, we have need assessment analysis, which runs for 2-3 days, and then target identification, which runs for 5-7 days, and there is actually project realization, which is for 100 to 120 days. So this, depending on the kind of manufacturing process, we can change it. And then the capacity building, which goes parallelly, which runs for 20 to 30 days. So this is the kind of intervention which NPC is having for MSME sector for any industry or for any plant or any manufacturing unit. This is the kind of approach that needs to be taken up. These are the details that what we do actually in any need assessment analysis. How do we analyze the readiness? There is a model on which we assess the readiness, and this assessment model actually we are going to place it on our website, so that any this is a self-assessment model. So any manufacturing unit which wants to do a self-assessment before they approach us, they can do this particular self-assessment and carry out their analysis. So So when you carry out this self-assessment model, you will get a radar chart in which various areas in which it requires some intervention, it will be projected in the same fashion, and then you will be able to know like what are the various low-hanging fruits and the long-term perspective that you need to take. Now, in order to have developed industry academia linkage, in what we are right now, we have taken this initiative that we are creating or we are establishing NPC eGrow Center at some of the universities. Right now we have on board 5 of the universities which are very well known universities like Sarada University and Manav Rachna universities. So these universities have actually collaborating with us, and we have established an NPC eGrow Center at those universities, and we will create these 3 verticals: Industry 4.0 vertical, then Marketing 4.0 vertical, and Enterprise 4.0 vertical. Now here I would like to refer to the earlier presentation that I had shown. That was the main reason why I had shown these slides, that the MSME sector, they have these problems. They have the problem of marketing, they have the problem of fund, they have the problem of improving their software efficiency, because they have the wherewithal, but they need handholding in these aspects. So what we are doing in this is that we are handholding the industry as well as the universities, the academia. We are creating strength in academia. We are building capacity in the academia through giving the exposure to the faculties and students, so that they become they are able to know what is Industry 4.0. They are able to appreciate the approach of Industry 4.0. Then we give them exposure along with the industry partners. We take these people or this academia and students to the industry, wherein they have hands-on experience under the guidance of technology experts or the solution providers. So in a way, we are creating a synergistic environment through this industry academia linkage. And this we have created in NCR region in 5 of the through these 5 of the universities, and we are replicating this throughout the country. So in a hub and spoke model, in the COE Center of Excellence at NPC headquarters at Delhi, this is the hub, and we are creating through this industry academia linkage spokes at these universities, as well as at our regional offices, NPC regional offices at Mumbai, Hyderabad, Gandhinagar, and all those places. So all those MSME units who are right now linked with us in this webinar, I would request them to get in touch with our offices at these locations, and they would be helped to they would our offices will help them to handhold to create these NPC eGrow Center. Similarly, for industry, all those industry who require like these type of intervention that they want to have in their manufacturing process to increase their improve their efficiency and improve their bottom line, they can approach our carry out such interventions to our regional offices. The mandate of NPC will be met, so that it, and we will be able to create an ecosystem throughout the country related to the Industry 4.0, and creating that environment of Industry 4.0, implementation of Industry 4.0. So this is the main idea or the main objective that we are working on this. So we need to create this process innovation, product innovation, and marketing innovation. from the business perspective, and then from the academia perspective, research, innovation, technology, training, and the training workforce and their entrepreneurship. And from the our part, we need to create that particular regulatory body called environment in which these industry and academia linkage is fruitful for the upgradation or the upliftment of the, so that there is a what you call the synergy or the meeting of demand and supply. So these the academia, they are able to inculcate or bring out those students who are already into knowledge of all these industry 4.0 concepts, and they are very well placed in this industry. So this is what we are carrying out. And to aid all these things, we are also developed these two credit systems so that these students, they get the theoretical as well as the practical aspects of Industry 4.0 to creating their, we are introducing two credit system in their first year, fourth year, second year, third year, fourth year for engineering. Similarly for other, even for arts, commerce, law, medical, every student is being given this particular exposure. And we foresee that in coming days, there will be more synergistic, more strong linkages between industry and academia is established. So I end up with my presentation for today, and I would request for any question.